All right, now in fairness, jeez, I got kind of goaded into that earlier this week. But that said, I'm willing to defend it. I'll back it up. A lot of people have made fun of me. Ryan Clark, no one makes fun of me better than you do. What'd you think of that?
Just looks sad.
I'm just, Greeny, I'm confused how you sounded like a cowboy from Ireland. If you were on the show Yellowstone, you would be the only Dutton that John Dutton wouldn't actually let live on the ranch. You'd probably have to go live on the Native American reservation because, first off, what we know is you ain't wrangling no horses, you ain't picking up no horse poop, and you're not doing no work outside. So it's actually impossible for you to be a cowboy or even be on the bandwagon, because to be on the bandwagon, you actually have to get dirty. So Greeny, stay with your Jets, stay with your high rises, stay with your losses. It's not for you to be a cowboy.
I don't know. I want to be a cowboy like Jerry Jones is a cowboy. I just want someone shining my glasses for me. I just want someone sitting behind me, and I just hand them the glasses, and they wipe them down. I'll leave the cleaning of the horse poop to other people. In the meantime, let's talk about the Cowboys. They got a Monday night game against the Eagles. Oh, did you see the shirt that Nick Sirianni wore to his press conference yesterday, clearly embracing the rivalry, with a shirt that said, "Beat Dallas." Sirianni and Zeke Elliott talked about the rivalry yesterday.
Yeah, I'll be wearing this all week. My kids got it. My wife has one, and yeah, we'll be wearing them.
It means a lot. I mean, definitely probably our biggest rival, especially since I've been here. You know, probably the team I don't like the most.
Would you like to see Coach McCarthy wear a T-shirt and says, "Beat the Eagles" or something worse?
Nah, we stay in our lane.
Okay, fair enough. So Sacho, taking all of the fun out of it, if you will. I guess it is kind of fun. This is the team that has just generally has gotten everything wrong for the last quarter of a century. Does it look to you like they've finally gotten it right?
Yeah, well, it does look like they've gotten it right, especially defensively. But real quick, going back to that rivalry, because I thought about this as I was listening and watching Sirianni. Mm-hmm. I grew up in Dallas. I was not a Cowboys fan. And it was a problem in my household, not only in my household, but also amongst my peers. I remember having a Philadelphia Eagles, and it was like a floor mat in my room. And people weren't happy about it. And so there is a true rivalry when it comes to the Dallas Cowboys and the Philadelphia Eagles. Now to the point of, has Dallas got it right? The answer is yes, and the reason is defense. And we talked about it for the last little bit of offseason. Greeny, you always say, the Cowboys are winning when it doesn't matter.
Right.
But now it matters. Mm-hmm. Their defense under Dan Quinn actually is better. Their defense with Micah Parsons, they're playing really well. And so, yes, we obviously understand the Cowboys' offense is going to be great, and I think Kellen Moore is one of the best young up-and-coming coordinators in this league. But defensively, Dan Quinn has got this team playing at a new level. I did not think they were going to go beat the LA Chargers, who have another good defense and a phenomenal quarterback. But they did it, and they keep on doing it week in and week out. I get it's only been 2 weeks. But defense wins championships, and Dallas has finally addressed their biggest issue over the last 3 years, their defense.
That's right, and two names have really emerged, and one of them you just mentioned is Dan Quinn, and the other, RC, is Micah Parsons, and I'd love you to share what you told us in the meeting this morning that you had heard about him, because I think this was just so illuminating about how good this kid is.
Yeah, just talking to people in the building, they believe that if coached correctly, now obviously you can't ask him to do certain things, that Micah Parsons has the foundation, has the athletic ability to play all 11 spots on defense, and that's corner to defensive tackle. And when you have a guy who is that versatile, the problem is you want them to do too many things. Let's think about what he did against the Los Angeles Chargers, because you heard Sam mention, or Sacho mention, what he was able to do, what he was able to bring to the game. They made Micah Parsons put his hand in the dirt, or I guess it's the turf now in 2021, mm-hmm. and he made plays. He put pressure on the quarterback constantly throughout the day. This defense still needs to grow. This defense still needs to get better. They probably still need one player on the back end. But when you watch who they are this year as compared to last year, making timely plays and situational football, turning the football over, putting pressure on the quarterback the way you thought you'd put pressure on the quarterback when you gave DeMarcus Lawrence all of that money, it's something different now. There's something different in the building. And I do believe the one thing we have to mention about the offense is that Dak is an alpha male. When you listen to Dak Prescott talk, and he talks about his confidence in his team, his confidence in his defense, you believe it. Now, we know that Mike McCarthy is a liar. We heard that. When he blamed Kellen Moore, and he blamed the camera, and he blamed whatever fat guy stood in front of Kellen Moore that couldn't see the clock. But what we do know, too, is that Dak Prescott isn't. And when you're led by a dude like that, and when you have a coach like Dan Quinn, you have a chance.
Yes, Prescott has been and is, I think, truly emerging as a true superstar. But you, Nink, said there's one word that jumps to your mind when you watch that defense play.
Confidence.
confidence. And when you can build confidence as a defense, then you start to believe that we can do this as a unit. And look, it's early in the season. They're going to have to build this confidence throughout the year so they look different week 14 than we see them in week two. Mm-hmm. So when you have players that are playing together as a unit and you're building that confidence and that camaraderie with each other, you understand, I know where you're going to be, you know where I'm going to be, we know the coverage is right, we know the front's right, and we can move people around. You have Parsons playing defensive end, getting after the quarterback. That's, you don't find guys that can play off the ball, get on the ball, put your hand on the ground, get after the quarterback. That is skill set that you're, that's hard to find, especially for a rookie. So that confidence is going to continue to grow.
As a rookie, is it a lot to ask from this player to do this many things?
For 17 games, yeah. It may be. We'll find that out. Look, there are special yes. players, and he may well be one. But even if he is, it's still, when you talk to rookie players at the end of their rookie seasons and you say, what's the biggest adjustment? More often than not, I hear the length of the season. Now, college seasons are getting a little longer, mm-hmm. but still not NFL length, and this year's NFL season longer than ever. So you wonder if it holds
hey guys,
up.
But
early returns on Parsons, obviously fantastic.
Yeah, RC.
We also have to remember Michael Parsons didn't play football last year.
Right.
Michael Parsons was an opt-out at Penn State throughout the COVID year. So this is just his first ball in over a year. So it will be interesting to see how they use him, but also see how they protect him as the season goes along.
Yes, these are the first two games he has played in two seasons. So far, so good for Micah Parsons. You'll see him on Monday. Look at some of the others here. Again, the Panthers will be playing the Cowboys, who first have the Eagles on Monday night. Sacha, what are you looking for in that game?
Yeah, I'm looking for the emergence of Tony Pollard. That's what I'm looking for. We know who Ezekiel Elliott is, but Tony Pollard has stepped up, ran for over 100 yards last week. TP, keep on doing your thing, my brother.
That's an interesting matchup. So is Chargers Chiefs. Graziano, what are you watching for in that good one in the AFC West?
I want to see if the Chiefs can stop somebody, especially in the run game. They've allowed 404 rushing yards in their first two games. And sure, it's Cleveland and Baltimore, maybe the two best running teams in the league, but the Chiefs need to slow somebody down on defense, and this week would be a good week to start.
Sunday night football, the Packers at the 49ers. Ryan Clark, what are you watching for in that game?
I'm looking for the defense of the Green Bay Packers against the San Francisco 49ers offense. I mean, all offseason, we searched for Aaron Rodgers. Can we look for something else? This offense of the San Francisco 49ers historically has given the Green Bay Packers fits, especially in that building. So now, what can you do this year? No Za'Darius Smith, you aren't stopping the run, and you need to find a corner. Kyle Shanahan will pinpoint all of these things and attack you. It's not about Aaron Rodgers this week. It's about stopping someone.
I like that. And then finally, Ninkovich, how about Bucks? Rams in LA.
This game is going to come down to who can score in the red zone. If you're scoring six instead of kicking field goals, that is going to be the outcome of this game. Can the Rams stop Tom from throwing it into the end zone with Gronk? We've seen him score four times this season. It's the efficiency in the red zone. Whoever can win that battle will win this game.
Well, this is such an interesting game. It is actually the only one on the schedule that our analytics believe the Bucs are not favored to win. But one wonders, are they looking ahead already, at least is that man looking ahead, to next week when Brady returns to Foxborough? Certainly his longtime trainer, Alex Guerrero, is already talking about that game. And he said, I think in time with Tom, as Tom got into his late 30s or early 40s, I think Bill was still trying to treat him like that 20-year-old kid that he drafted. And all the players, I think, realized Tom was different. He's older, so he should be treated differently. And all the players, none of them would have cared that he was treated differently. I think that was such a Bill thing. He never evolved. So you can't treat someone who's in his 40s like they're 20. It doesn't work. Those comments got a lot of attention yesterday. Tom Brady had this reaction.
Everyone has, you know, protective feelings and emotions as friends and family members, and that's just part of being in sports. And you have a lot of people who you know, because they're not out there, they want to protect, and it's a very caring, loving thing that a lot of people do. But you know, from my standpoint, I had a great time, but really my focus has been on trying to be the best I could be for this team and trying to go out and be a winning quarterback, be a championship level quarterback for this team and this organization, because they certainly deserve it. And you know, I made a commitment to them and I want to live up to it.
Okay, so endlessly interesting to say the least. And we begin with Ninkovich because you were there, obviously, in New England and played for them. So people talked all about this. I mean, it's not a secret that when Brady was there, he was someone who was still being treated like he was any other player on that team. Can you give us an illustration of what that looked like?
Well, I think the difference in coaching a player and how a player trains are two different things. Mm-hmm. So Bill, the way he would coach,
you knew going into that building, it didn't matter if you were a first-year player, if you were in your 20th year, didn't matter. He's going to coach everybody hard. He's going to make sure that everybody is at their best, because a coach is supposed to make